just here and pray then. Making everything. Hey there, everybody. We are going to get started here. I hope you're doing well. I hope you're in a place that's dry and not too windy. It's a little bit of a mess out there tonight. And so thank you for joining me here tonight. I am just sitting here looking at a couple of these messages here. I wanted to give you a little bit of info on what I've learned and heard in the last couple days. I had a privilege to be in Columbia since Sunday. We had a one-day mission school Sunday, and then we had our Baptist State Convention Tuesday, all day from like 8:30 in the morning until after 9:30 last night, and then today I drove back home. I got here a little bit after lunch today, so it was it's been a great several days, and I'm excited about our state convention and what's going on there. And it was just encouraging and refreshing, as I shared with a friend today on a text. It was refreshing. It's been since Sunday, or actually probably Saturday, I haven't seen the news. I haven't talked much about politics or seen much negativity at all, because we've been saturated with God's Word and talking about ministry and serving and missions, and it's just been a really good time. So I am thankful to be able to go to our state convention and the one-day mission school, and it was very enjoyable, and I learned a lot. So hopefully the church can benefit from those things. And there are some great upcoming events that I'll share with you later. One is a virtual trip to East Asia. It's coming up in a few weeks, and I'll share the details with that with you later on. But one of the statistics that I heard, and this came from some of the missionaries, our international missionaries, who actually serve in East Asia or different places, that one out of every four people on the planet is from East Asia, is born in East Asia. One out of every four. That may help you to understand why there's such a push to send missionaries to Eastern Asia. There's so many people that haven't heard the gospel. And one-fourth of the total population on our planet is in that area in East Asia. I also found out that Becca, the young lady that came to spend some time with us several weeks ago, her dad was there at the one-day school, and the missionaries know of her. So we need to continue to pray for her. But I'm just thankful to have been there. And you can actually, if you want to check out what it's about, you can download the South Carolina Baptist State Convention app on your phone or computer, and you can watch the videos of the whole convention. We had some great speakers, and a lot of very powerful things were said. This is the 200th year of our convention, and there was a lot of history given about how the convention started and how Southern Baptist in general got started. So it was very informative. Again, thank you for joining me here tonight. I want to encourage you to share the videos, the Bible studies, invite people to join us on Facebook, or let them know that it's on YouTube as well. This is a wonderful way for us to get the word out. I talked to several pastors and heard several testimonies this week, where their congregations are flourishing, their ministries are growing because of Facebook and YouTube, and how social media has helped them get the word out. And I want us to do the same. This gives us a great opportunity to let people know they can study the Bible and they don't have to come in a building that they may feel very intimidated about doing. So It gives us an opportunity to share the gospel in a different way. So I wanted to encourage you about that. Let me pray with you, and then I'll continue on, okay? Thank you, Lord, for this night. Thank you for shelter and things that we may take for granted. I thank you for technology and the possibility that we have to get the word out across our state and our nation and our world. And I thank you that once our Bible study is aired, that anyone can find it. And from now on, and I pray that many people would come to know you because they hear the gospel, even through Facebook or YouTube or whatever it is. So thank you for giving us this opportunity, and pray that you would continue to work in our lives to teach us to be instruments that are used by you, instruments that spread the gospel. And I thank you, Lord, for your kindness to us. In Jesus' name, amen. One of the questions that was posed during the convention was, when we talk about the gospel and spreading the gospel and getting the word out, the guy that was talking said that it's really not a question of whether you believe what's in Scripture or not. A lot of people say we believe that the Scripture is true. The question is, do we believe that Jesus Christ is worthy of us following him and being obedient to him? Is he that important to us? It's something to really think about. While you're doing that, a couple announcements here and some things I want to bring you up to speed on. First of all, today is Veterans Day, and I just want to thank all of those that served our country. It's been a tough year, and even last year, as our veterans were disrespected in a lot of ways. And I wanted to thank our veterans and encourage you to thank our veterans. And some of you may be those veterans. So thank you for your service. Thank you for laying your lives on the line for the benefit of others, even those that would protest or disrespect your service. You still were willing to give whatever it cost you so that they could still have the freedom to do that, to speak out. So thank you for your service, and thank you for guaranteeing us, at least to this point, our freedom. We take it for granted all the time. Also, I want to let you know that our children and our youth are going to start meeting on Wednesdays. The teen kids and our young people, youth, teenagers, you have a place to come. You have an opportunity to come and hear the gospel and to fellowship with one another and to grow together. And so I encourage you to do that. While we're doing this streaming, they're meeting in the back and with social distancing and wearing the mask. So encourage you to do that. Invite people. If you have a neighbor with children, and volunteer to bring them. Tell them what's available. Let us know. If you can't bring them, we'll come and get them. So we appreciate you doing that. Also, excuse me, I wanted to remind you about Operation Christmas Child, those shoe boxes. We have 15 left here that haven't been filled yet, so we want to fill those last 15. This Sunday will be our dedication Sunday, where we will hold those boxes in our hands and pray over those boxes and dedicate those boxes so we can send them out next week. And that's the National Collection Week is next week. So let's make sure we get all our boxes back in. And if you haven't taken any, please let us know. I'll bring these boxes to you and you can pack them. There's a label inside that tells you exactly what to pack, what not to pack. And that's very helpful. You don't have to put any money in it. As a matter of fact, we don't want you to put money in the boxes. Just want you to pack the boxes with what's required or requested there on the label. And this year you can keep track of those boxes. It has a UPC or I guess that's what it's called on the label, so you can keep track of where your box actually goes. Also, this Sunday or this month is Thanksgiving, and usually at Homewood we have a great meal and we have a joint service together with Emmanuel's congregation, and we can't do that this year because of the coronavirus, and I wish that wasn't the case, but it is. So the morning of the 22nd, we're going to have our Thanksgiving service. And there is a box just right outside of my office here where you can drop off this I am thankful note. And this, I mentioned this to you Sunday. It just says, I am thankful for Just fill that out and drop it in the box right here on the Next Steps counter so that the Sunday morning, the 22nd, we can share those. There's several in the box right now from this past Sunday. I would encourage you to fill those out, drop them in that box so we can give the Lord thanks for all the things that He's done and given us. Even in 2020, we are still a blessed people. We might be inconvenienced, but we're still blessed beyond measure. So let's give God thanks for everything that He's done and given us this past year. I think that's most of the announcements I needed to share with you. I wanted just to read a note here that was in the bulletin about Veterans Day, just as a reminder, because sometimes we get Veterans Day and Memorial Day confused. Veterans Day is a tribute to military veterans who have served in the U.S. Armed Forces, not to be confused with Memorial Day, which honors those who died while in service. Veterans Day honors all military veterans, including those still with us. Let's honor all of America's veterans this week for their bravery, sacrifice, and love for their country. We wanted to do that and just remind you of what that is as we celebrate Veterans Day. And it's really a time to thank people for giving everything and being willing to give of themselves for the benefit of the rest of us. I wanted to go back over our prayer list briefly and just remind you of some updates there. This is from Sunday in the bulletin. If you'll remember from our prayer list, continue to remember Sonia and me as well. And I thank the Lord for letting me get through the convention with my back. And right now it's much better. And anyway, thank you. Thank the Lord and thank you for your prayers. Continue to remember Miss Linda Tyler and family, Rudy and Marilyn Causey, James and Judy Carroll. James and Judy are improving, but they still have a ways to go. Judy still has fever and she has to put up with James. Just kidding, James. But anyway, pray for them. Pat and Jean Moore, continue to pray for them as well. Calvin Barfield is having a lot of pain with his back, lower back, and pray for Calvin. He's in a tough spot. Also, Sharon and Mike Muir, continue to pray for them and the things that they're going through. Larry Harrington, Doris Harrington, Cameron Harrington. And Paula Thibodeau was a praise this week. That changed from a prayer concern to a praise. Also, continue to remember my sister Debbie, Barbara Bryant, other medical workers, those that are dealing with this virus. The numbers are crazy. Depends on which day you watch, which day you listen to that. So continue to remember those folks. Also, our North American missionaries. I got to see some of those and talk to some of those folks this past week, and also international missionaries who were home furloughed because of coronavirus. And some of them are just wishing they could get back on the field because of the coronavirus. It's something that I didn't think about, is how many of our missionaries had to come home or back to the States because they had to leave the country where they were serving for a time. Also, remember the health of our country post-election, and I don't know exactly if that's the right title for that, but pray for our nation. Don't just talk about it. Let's pray. That's what the church is to do. Sunday school and small groups, we're trying to figure this out with everybody else, but we have to move forward, folks. The church cannot just wait till things are different or better. We've got to find a way to move forward. I encourage our teachers, small group leaders, find a way to not just maintain, but to move forward and to invite people to spread the gospel in different ways, however we can do that. Someone said at the convention this week, the Holy Spirit's strong enough to get the word out, even through a mask and 6 feet away. So He's still that effective. So let's keep that in mind. Continue to remember Miss Helen Hardwick, Josh and Emma Poole. Emma's our niece, and she's still going through a really tough time. So remember Josh and Emma and family. Laura Haruska, Lois Graham family. Miss Lois passed away, and that's Miss Eunice's sister and other family members here. Garnett's aunt and so forth, continue to remember Miss Phyllis and family. There's just a lot of folks tied to this family. I understand that the funeral is a graveside funeral tomorrow in Mullins at 11 o'clock. That's the Lois Graham family we need to pray for, and that's a graveside in Mullins tomorrow at 11 o'clock at Devotion Gardens. Devotion Gardens. So keep that in mind. Hold on just a second. Don't go anywhere. The laptop is losing power, so hold on. We're almost there. There we go. All right. Okay, we're back. So, hope I didn't lose you. That's the Lois Graham family, Ginger Tyler, and David had just said that Crystal, continue to pray for David and Crystal McVeigh. Crystal's still in need of employment and still struggling with that. So lift Crystal up if you would. Donna Mulligan, continue to remember Donna and Mike Mulligan. Mike has been here at Homewood with Calvin, and he presented a gospel, the gospel here. Donna's having a real tough time, and need to pray for them. Steve Edge, continue to pray for Steve as he recovers from his fall, which was several weeks ago. Mr. Truman Hawkins, continue to pray for Truman and Wileen. Becca, which I mentioned earlier, the international missionary who was here with us, and she's counting on our prayers. Tom and Helen Hurl, I believe they see us and watch sometimes, and pray for them and their ministry and their safety. Also, Jeff Edwards, Johnny Heiler, this Patricia's daughter who's here in town with them now. Johnny Heiler, David Alexander, appreciate those that went to see David and visit with him. Many unspoken requests, and there was another one added Sunday that just didn't feel comfortable giving us the details, but certainly said, please add them to the unspoken request. The Lord knows exactly who I'm talking about, and so let's lift those folks up. And the hurricane victims, we're experiencing a little bit of weather from Eta, so continue to remember those who are affected by the hurricanes. And our students and teachers. There's a lot of things going on with the school still, and a lot of unrest there. Also, we do want to add Miss Grace Granger called today. Stuart Granger. Remember Stuart? He also hurt his back, and we've been praying for him and continue to lift Stuart up in prayer. Also, Ashley Lively, I believe, is a granddaughter. We've prayed, lifted Ashley up in prayer before, and there's a mass behind her eye. She needs to be continued to lift up us lifting her up in prayer. So continue to remember Ashley Lively. Tom Roberts family, this is Calvin's uncle, Tom Roberts. Please put them in your prayers. That's Tom Roberts family. And I'll mention the Lois Graham family. So quite a lot of prayer concerns, and if you can't remember those, just give me a call or text, and I'll try to get those back to you. And we will pray before we leave today. So lift those folks up in prayer. I want to share something with you because sometimes we lose our focus, and we get all tied up in our circumstances and the things going on around us. You know, we can lose focus, just like Peter when he got out of the boat, and a lot of things going on around. It was easy, very easy to lose focus, and we're no different. And so sometimes we need to refocus a little. So I want to share this with you. It's actually a devotion for today. Billy Graham wrote this. It says, someday we will go to a home where all is happiness, joy, and peace. How barren our lives would be if we didn't have this hope, wouldn't it? Knowing heaven is real will make a difference in the way we live. For one thing, we won't become attached to the things of this world. We will say with Paul, I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. Philippians 4:11. What a powerful statement. But heaven should also give us a burden for those who do not have this hope. Every day you meet people who do not know Christ. Will you tell them? I have to tell you that that was probably the main theme of the state convention and the mission school this week. It was getting the word out. I was sharing with Sandy earlier today that hearing a lot of statistics this week, one of the ones that got my attention and kept it is that every second, two people pass away on this globe. Every second, two people go into eternity. Now you think about that. Every minute, that's 120 people who pass away. Every minute, 120 people. And if those folks don't know Christ, they're headed straight to hell. And folks, we can't just be concerned about where we're going, but we have to let others know that there's an alternative. There's a better way, there's a better place, and there's life in Jesus. So the question is very pertinent. Will we tell them about Jesus? And when I read that devotion, one of the scripture there in Philippians 4:11 stands out because Paul says, I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. Have we? Are we content in whatever state we find ourselves in? Because our eyes are on the Lord Jesus. And we are waiting for that time when he comes for his children. As a matter of fact, this Sunday, we've been in 1 Thessalonians for several weeks, and this Sunday we're moving into the latter part of chapter 4, verses 13 through 18, which speaks of the rapture, and we're going to talk about what that means. No, the word's not doesn't say rapture in that passage, but that's what it's talking about, and we'll talk about that too. So that's this Sunday. So we have to remember what's coming, and life here on this earth is temporary, and we have eternity coming. So we have to keep focused on what's eternal and what's so important. And I want to help you to do that, encourage you to focus on what's eternal. And don't get so weighed down on what's temporary. Everything's passing away. But the things that are eternal will stay, will remain. So tonight we're in James, in the last part of James. We're finishing up here. James chapter 5, verses 13 through 19. James 5, 13 through 19. And next Wednesday, Lord willing, we're going to see what the other sibling has to say, which would be Jude. James and Jude are brothers, and they are also half-brothers of Jesus. So we might wonder what it was like to grow up in a house with a perfect brother. Well, James and Jude give us a little insight into not just that aspect, but what following Christ is all about. Hopefully we've learned some things from James, and we'll learn some things tonight from James in the latter part of this chapter. So as we turn to James 5, 13 through 19, I want you to watch this video, and I'm going to try to get this to where you can see it and hear it clearly. So I'll get it started, and then I'll make sure the lights are where they need to be so you can hear. So let's see if we can do this without turning something off or knocking something over here. No promises.
Because he says there in verse 13, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him. His point is, okay, are you suffering? Pray. You happy? Pray. You sick? Pray. Like your first response should always be God, upward. And so often that's not our first response. it's we find comfort from some other people, or we try to take things into our own hands. And he says, man, if it's the happiest day of your life, you should be so in love with God. You know when you're just madly in love with someone and you have good news, you want to tell them first. Or if you've got bad news, you want to tell them first. And so that's the idea behind James, is that God is supposed to be the center, the core of my life. And so if I'm going through a hard time, man, I come before him, before everyone else. And if things are great, I just immediately just burst out in praise, because I realize it all came from him. And I think so often, he's not our first response. So look at your life. I mean, is he the first love of your life? You know, when I first started studying James years ago, I used to think it was just a bunch of, maybe anecdotes, a little bit of wisdom, a kind of to-do list. But when you look deeper, you realize, no, this is about having a deep, deep relationship with God. It's about knowing him, and it's about, gosh, everything in my life revolves around him. And so if I'm cheerful, he's the first one I'm going to sing praise to. And if I'm suffering, he's the first one I'm going to talk to. And he says, if you're sick, he says, then call for the elders of the church. Let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. He says, get the elders, get them to pray, because hopefully these are the righteous people in the church. And he says, there's a power in the prayers of the righteous. He says, confess your sins to one another. I know that when we've prayed for people as elders, we'll even give them time and say, is there anything you need to confess before we anoint you with oil and pray for you? Because we want to be pure before God and say, God, you know what? Maybe there are times in Scripture when people were sick because of their sin. That's not a law. That's not the way it always is. Jesus made that clear. But there have been other times where, you know what? It's an opportunity for you to evaluate your life and confess if you've been living in rebellion. But he's saying, gather them together. You could see healing. Like, do you believe these things? I mean, that's the idea of studying the Word of God, is that we still believe that these words are true. I mean, we've been walking through this book of James with you, and as you've seen, man, we're not pulling anything crazy out of there. It's just simple reading, and our hope is that you would start picking up the Bible if you don't already, and just getting alone, and just reading it by yourself, and getting so close to God that your first response in everything in life is, I got to go to him. Okay, this is really tough. What do? I got to get in his presence. And notice that the person who's sick is to call for the elders of the church. It's not that the elders of the church just go around looking for sick people, but there's an act of faith that you take on your part, going, gosh, I really believe in the Word of God, so my act of faith is to call the elders and say, hey, would you come here? Would you pray over me? Would you anoint me with oil? Because I really believe that you could heal me, that God could heal me through you, and it's about following these proper channels. And then comes maybe my favorite verse in the Bible. It's James 5:17, and it says, Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain, and for 3 years and 6 months it did not rain on the earth. Then he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and earth bore its fruit. But just that first part, Elijah was a man with a nature like ours. Some Bible verses say, Elijah was a man just like us. Okay, why do I love this? Because, hey, Elijah's one of my heroes, as I read in the Bible. Like, that story on top of that mountain, Mount Carmel, when he calls down fire from heaven and with the prophets of Baal, and he just takes them all on, and fire comes down from heaven, the miracles, the boldness. And then God says here, hey, Elijah was a man with a nature just like yours. In other words, Elijah's no different from you. And he was able to pray, and it stopped rain for 3.5 years. His whole point is, look, he's got nothing on you. So often we'll look at people in the Bible as though they were different from us. Okay? I mean, come on, admit it. Don't you think of King David and go, well, I'm no King David. I'm no Moses. I'm no Elijah. And what this verse is, yes, you are. He was a human being. He was no different from you. Man, when I first understood that verse, I go, wait, I'm praying in the same way that Elijah did. And he has nothing on me. David had nothing on me. Moses had nothing. Moses, who went on that mountaintop and encountered God, I can do the same thing. Like, do you believe that about yourself? For too many years, we've put people in this book up on a pedestal as though it's unattainable. And James is saying, look, they were no different. I've had people say that to me. They go, well, you're Francis Chan. I'm like, what in the world does that even mean? I'm a person. You're a person. Elijah was a person. And yet he could pray and stop the rain. He could pray and call down fire from heaven. It's an amazing thought. And I got to ask you, do you have that type of faith? Do you really believe you could have this intimacy with God like David did? And do you believe that God could respond to your prayers like he did to Elijah? Seriously, answer that question. And then he closes it and he says, my brothers, if anyone among you wanders from the truth and someone brings him back, let him know that whoever brings back a sinner from his wandering will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. So he closes the book of James by saying, look, if any of you basically help someone turn from their sins and back to God, you understand you are saving them from a world of hurt. You know, we just talked about these prayers and how we have the power, like the elders can pray for you and you can literally be healed because our prayers are the same as that of Elijah. They're powerful. And then he closes with the greatest miracle, which is God could possibly be using you to turn others back to him. And that's a huge miracle to watch someone turn from the error of their way and turn back to God, that God could be using you to change someone's eternal destiny. But do you believe that? That your prayers could have that much power and that God could use you to turn others from a multitude of sins? What an amazing thought. That you could have an impact on someone's eternity. Do you believe these words? See, God wants us to go and act. Remember, the book of James is about a living faith where you read it and you go, you know what, Lord? I want you to do that through me. I'm going to take a step of faith. I need to talk to someone right now. Maybe you're going to use me to bring them to you. Man, act upon this book. And my prayer is, as we're done with this study, is that this definitely will not be your last time in the Word of God, but that now, that maybe this will be a springboard for you where your natural response is, man, I want to know him. I want to know him. I want him to be the first love of my life. So when life gets difficult, that's just my obvious choice is to go to him. And when I'm just so excited, my first thought is I just want to praise God and worship him. And anything that happens in life, it's about him and going to him.
All right. That's some pretty powerful stuff. He does such a great job of explaining the scriptures to us, and I'm thankful we can use that. I wanted to back up and just walk you through a little bit, a couple places here in the scripture. He starts out here in James 5:13 as saying, is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing praises. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And what Francis Chan was saying is the first response, the first person that they turn to is Jesus. And he's saying, you do the same. May God be the first person that you think of when you're happy, when you're sad, when you're going through whatever. He's the one you want to talk to. He asked the question, is he the first love of your life? Is he the first love of your life? That person that you want to go and share everything with. Think about that, because he needs to be. He should be. He has to be if you and I are going to go forward in this Christian life. Is Jesus the number one person in our lives? James says, is anyone suffering? Let him pray. Cheerful. Let him sing praises. to God. Is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders. I did want to stop here just a second and say that this word's translated a couple different ways in Scripture, and this particular word here, elders, is the word presbyteros, which means older or aged. It actually means the older folks. Call together those who are older. And back in the Bible days, sometimes very different than our days, it was the older members of the congregation that were respected. And yes, many times, most of the time, it was the older ones who held offices in the church as well. They were just looked up to and respected. And so this word, it means call together those who are older or aged, is what the word means, presbyteros, of the church, and let them pray over them, him or her, anointing him, excuse me, in the name of the Lord. And the prayer offered in faith will restore the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up. If he has committed sins, they will be forgiven him. The question that always comes here is, now wait a minute, what if we pray over this person and they're not healed? Okay? This James ends this letter the same way he began, and that's with a focus on prayer. Okay? Someone once said that prayer is knowing what God's going to do. I disagree, and I don't think the scripture bears that out. Faith is trusting that whatever God decides to do, he's going to act on his behalf and what's best for you and for me. It's a matter of trusting. Remember, Paul prayed that God would remove the thorn in his flesh. In 2 Corinthians, you can find it there, 2 Corinthians 12, I think it's 12:10. He prayed three times. He entreated God. He begged God, please remove this from me. Well, we would think that Paul certainly would be a man of great faith. However, the Lord said no. He said, my faith is sufficient for you, for my strength is perfected in your weakness. Paul says, okay, all right. Have it your way. I'm well content then with these distresses and insults and persecutions and trials. For when I am weak, then I am strong. So just because we pray in faith doesn't mean he's going to answer the way we want him to. But it does mean he's going to answer, and he hears that prayer. So pray in faith. And remember, in this passage, James couples the element of physical healing as well as spiritual. He says, restore the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed sins, they will be forgiven him. Therefore, confess your sins to one another. I want to stop here just a second, because sometimes we have to stop and think, just like with me and my back, okay? And several of you are going through some tough times physically. It is something that a believer must stop and assess. God, is there something in my life that you're trying to get my attention about so I can see it and I can repent of it, I can confess it? God has a way of slowing us down or stopping us in our tracks to say, God, you know, this physical problem is uncomfortable, but I'm only going to be in this physical body for a short time. What's most important is my spiritual well-being and my eternal well-being and destination. And I have to tell you that there's things in my own life that since my back started hurting, I had to come before the Lord and start to talk with him about these things. Sometimes they're blind spots, things that you and I may not even have recognized earlier. Sometimes they're just things that we just kind of wink at or say, God, that's not a big deal. Surely that's not a problem. So yes, God uses physical ailments to get our attention about spiritual ailments. And James here is saying, you take the physical problems as an opportunity to at least do some evaluation and see. So he says, therefore, confess your sins to one another, which is interesting, not just to God, but to one another, and pray for one another so that you may be healed. There's something substantial about confessing, an acknowledgement, an agreement of the sin that we have in our lives or the things that we're partaking in, so that we can have that healing, so that we can have just get it off our chest and not carry that guilt around or that shame around. And that's what James is talking about. And folks, we've talked about this before, and doctors have acknowledged this, that the physical ailments a lot of times are tied to our emotional and mental ailments and our spiritual things. They're all interconnected. And that's why a lot of times we have ulcers sometimes, because we have this shame and this guilt and unconfessed sin, and we're wrestling with things that we really should have given to God a long time ago. And that's what James is saying. And then he says the effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. And then he gives us an example of what this looks like. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly, expecting in faith, earnestly, that it might not rain, and it did not rain on the earth for 3.5 years, 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the sky poured rain, and the earth produced its fruit. So James is saying, listen, the effective prayer of a righteous person can accomplish anything. What does that mean? It means someone righteous is in right standing with God. So first of all, the effective prayer of someone who is right with God. And that goes back to what he's already said. We got to make sure we're right with God before we go to him in prayer and petition. So let's do some self-evaluation and say, God, if you see anything in me that I'm not aware of or that I'm not acknowledging, please show me. So the effective prayer of a righteous person, that availeth much. Okay, there's some conditions there. And just like Francis Chan said, Elijah was just a man. He was just flesh and bones, just like we are. He put himself in the right position. He followed God. He trusted in God. He listened to God, and he did what God said, and there were results in his life. And so many times we don't want to listen to God. We just want him to do what we want him to do. And it doesn't work that way at all. So it says that he prayed, and it poured rain. Earth produced its fruit. Verse 19, my brethren, if any among you strays from the truth and one turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. I want to close here with just something that's a takeaway from this last verse. There's an assumption here from these last two verses. My brethren, if any among you strays from the truth and one turns him back. Now, how is someone going to turn someone else back unless they have knowledge of what this person's doing? Look at the words. My brethren, if any among you strays from the truth and one or someone else turns that person back, let him know that he who turned the sinner from the error of his way will save his soul from death and will cover a multitude of sins. So many times we use this out of context phrase, who am I to judge? And that's a cop out, folks, because the scripture is very clear about order. And the passage that we refer to so many times, it talks about don't judge lest you are going to be judged or want to be judged in the same manner. And it says to make sure you take the log out of your own eye before you go to your brother or sister to remove the speck out of their eye. And then it says, and then go to them. So this thing that we flippantly throw out there is, who am I to judge, is an excuse. It's not a biblical mandate. It's an excuse. God says, make sure your own life is right first. Make sure you're right with me. Then go and love your brothers and sisters enough to say, hey, this thing that you're doing, this business deal, this way you're talking or relating to people, or the way that you're treating your own body, or these things are detrimental to you and they're not healthy and they're going to cause you problems in your spiritual walk. That takes a love beyond just what's comfortable, a love beyond saying, oh, who am I to judge? I tell you who we are. We're people who are supposed to love our brothers and sisters enough to go to them in love and do exactly what James says. If that person has strayed from the truth and one turns him back. So if I see someone who is straying from the truth, we have to acknowledge they're straying from the truth. That requires a judgment call. They're straying from the truth. And then that person turns that person back, which it just means in practical terms, We go to that person in love and we acknowledge and we talk to them and we identify, hey, I noticed this in your walk and I want to pray with you about this and I want to talk to you about this and I understand according to God's word, this is going to cause you problems. This is not pleasing to God. This is going to cause you to stumble in your walk. And that person then has the opportunity to agree and confess that sin and repent of that sin and walk away and get up the next day without the guilt or shame of what they've been carrying around because they had a loving brother or sister who went to them in love and said, listen, there's a problem. So that's what James is saying. And it says, hey, wouldn't it be great if we knew that one of our brothers or sisters were now in right standing with God because we love them enough to go to them and say, hey, let's talk about this issue. So that's what how James ends there. And I wanted to just go back and remind you how we started this and what James said at the beginning of this letter. He says, James, a bond servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, a bond servant of God, bought with a price, to the 12 tribes who were dispersed abroad, greetings. He's writing to a persecuted people. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. And that's not perfect like I'm never going to mess up again. It's perfect like complete in God. Okay? Lacking in nothing. Verse 5. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all men generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. Verse 6, but let him ask in faith without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. So James started his letter like that, and he ended it talking about faith and talking about the importance of us really believing in God. So thank you for joining me tonight and joining in the study. And again, Lord willing, next Wednesday we will move toward a study in Jude, which is James' natural brother, his sibling, and the Lord Jesus' half-brother, his earthly brother, along with James, and see what Jude has to say. Sunday morning, Lord willing, we will be in 1 Thessalonians in chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. We're going to talk about the rapture, the capturing up of the people of God, something that we're to look forward to, something that we're to keep our eyes on and have an excitement about what's coming. And folks, I just before I pray and dismiss or close, I just wanted to encourage you to take the good news of the gospel, to live under its authority and the freedom, the liberation that comes from God's word, and pass it on. Pass it on, folks. It's not just for us to keep. It's for us to enjoy, to live, to live in that reality, and it's for us to tell other people every second. Two people pass into eternity. Every second, two people pass into eternity. Let's do everything we can to make sure there's more and more people who hear the gospel and who have an opportunity to end their life here, knowing that they're heading into eternity with Jesus Christ. Let me pray with you. Heavenly Father, thank you for your kindness to us. Thank you for your holy word. And I thank you, Lord, that you emphasize prayer in your word and talking with you and believing and having faith. And I pray, Father, we would follow what your word has to say for us tonight. And I pray that you would find us to be faithful. Not just people who come to you and pray when we're in need, but people who are obedient to you and follow you and trust you and allow you to live your life through us. People who are connected to the body of Christ, who encourage one another and lift each other up, and also people just like James wrote, Lord, as you inspired him to write, that we are to go to our brothers and sisters in love. And Help them to identify things in their lives that may cause problems. Lord, thank you for loving us the way you do. I thank you for hearing our prayer concerns tonight and being with those families going through struggles and trials. And I pray that you'd be with Miss Lois's family tomorrow as they have that graveside service. I pray that you'd be with she and her family, with her family. And also, Lord, those others that we mentioned in the prayer concerns, the unspoken request, and all those who are really struggling. And thank you, Lord, for answered prayers. We give you praise for who you are and thanks for what you've done. In Jesus' name, amen. I hope you all have a wonderful, safe night, and I hope to see you one way or the other Sunday morning. Thank you.